In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to make Pong, a simple but very addictive game that was released back in 1973 by Atari. It is a very simple game by today's standards, but it was a massive hit in its day. We are going to build this game using Python and the Pygame module. In order to be able to follow this tutorial, I expect you to have a basic knowledge of the Python programming language. If not, I strongly suggest you to watch my Python for Absolute Beginners playlist. It will teach you everything you need to know in just a couple of hours. Also, I have prepared two small cheat sheets for you. A Python cheat sheet which covers the basic Python concepts we are going to use, and a Pygame cheat sheet, which covers the basic Pygame functions we are going to use. You can download them for free from the video description. Although Pong is a very simple game, it covers a lot of the aspects of computer game programming, like movement, control, collision detection, scoring, artificial intelligence, and so on. If you learn how to program Pong, you will be able to program a lot of other games as well. So, let's start at once. Our goal today is to develop Pong. It sounds very daunting, but don't worry. In programming, we use a technique called divide and conquer, which means that we break a complex problem into smaller, more manageable pieces. Then, we solve each piece individually and put all the pieces back together to form the complete solution. So, that's what we are going to do. We are going to break Pong down into smaller pieces and then write code to solve each piece. Here is a list with the pieces we need to solve. Install the Pygame module, create a blank screen and the game loop, draw the arena, the paddles and the ball, move the ball around, check for a collision with all edges, move the player's paddle, move the CPU paddle with artificial intelligence, check for a collision with the paddles, and finally add scoring. Now that we know what we need to do, let's get started. The first thing we need to do is to install the Pygame module because it does not come with Python. Pygame is a set of Python modules designed for writing computer games. It makes it easy to write video games that have good performance and are fun for people to play. You can install Pygame using pip. On a terminal window, we type pip install pygame and we wait until the installation finishes. Now we can open our favorite code editor and start typing our code. I am using Sublime Text to code in Python. The first thing we have to do is to import the Pygame module. We type import Pygame and then we run the program. If the program runs with no errors, it means that the Pygame module is installed correctly and we can start developing our game. The first step out of the 9 steps to complete our Pong game is completed. The next step is to create a blank screen and the game loop. First of all, let's talk about the game structure. Every game consists of 2 parts. The part where we define our variables, our game objects, like the player paddle, the ball, the arena, etc. The other part is the game loop, which is responsible for updating the positions of the game objects and checking for collisions. The game loop is like the heartbeat of the game. The game loop runs over and over again until we close the game. So, in each iteration of the game loop, we have to draw the game objects in their new positions and check if there were any collisions. This happens so fast that we perceive it as continuous movement. Now, let's create a blank screen and the game loop. First of all, we need to initialize Pygame, so we type pygame.init. Then we create a display surface. A display surface is like a blank canvas where we can draw our game objects. We need to specify the width and the height of the display surface. I am going to use a size of 1280 by 800 pixels. So let's create 2 variables to hold the width and the height of the screen. screen width is equal to 1280 and screen height is equal to 800. And then we create the display surface. Screen is equal to pygame.display.setMode, and now we need a tuple, screen width, comma, screen height. This line of code creates a display surface object named screen. The setMode functions take a tuple as an argument. The first value is the width and the second value is the height of the display. The origin of the display surface we created is the top left corner, so a point at 0,0 is at top left. For a point at the center of the screen, we can use the width and the height of the display to find its x and y values. Display width divided by 2, display height divided by 2, which in our case is 640 by 400. Now that we have created the screen, we need to give it a title. We do that by using the setCaption function, pygame.displaySetCaption, parenthesis, my Pong game. Next, we create a clock object like this. Clock is equal to pygame.time.clock. Be careful, we need a capital C here. We need this clock object to control the frame rate of the game, how fast the game will run. Don't worry about this line of code now, we will get back to it in a minute. The basic setup of the game is now complete. Let's now work on the game loop. The game loop consists of three parts. First, we have to check for any events. Events are things that happen in the game that we need to respond to, like quitting the game, moving the paddle, and so on. Then we have to update the positions of all the game objects. And lastly, we have to draw all the game objects in the new positions. We start the game loop with a while loop like this, while true. The while loop will run over and over again until we close the game. The first thing we do inside the while loop is to check for any events. Don't run the game before completing the code of the while loop. If you run the code at this point, the while loop will run forever, since we haven't defined a way to stop its execution. That's what we're going to do now. For event in pygame.event.get. This line of code gets all the events that Pygame recognizes and happened since the last time the while loop ran and puts them in a list. Then we loop through the list of events and check if any of the events is the quit event. The quit event is when we click on the close button of the window. If the event is the quit event, we break out of the while loop. If event.type is equal to pygame.quit, then we have to quit the game. Pygame.quit, and then we have to close the program completely with the command sys.exit. This command is part of the sys module, so we have to import it like this. In the first line of the code, after importing pygame, we type comma sys. That's it. Now we have defined a way to exit the game. But we need a couple more lines of code before running our game for the first time. We have to update the screen with this line of code, pygame.display.update. This line of code takes all the changes we made in the game objects and draws a picture from them. Since we haven't created any game objects yet, this line just draws a black screen. Remember the clock object we created in the beginning? We need to use it now. We have to tell the clock object how fast the game should run. We do that by using the tick function. The tick function takes an integer as an argument, and that integer is the number of frames per second that we want. I am going to use 60 frames per second. Clock.tick 60. That's it. If we don't define a frame rate for our game, the computer will try to run the game as fast as it can. So the game speed will depend on the speed of the computer. By defining a frame rate, we make sure that the game runs at the same speed on every computer. For this game, we defined that we want to run this while loop and update the display 60 times per second. Now that the game loop is complete, we can run the game for the first time. If we run the game at this point, we won't see anything because we haven't drawn anything yet. But the important thing is that we can now reliably close the game by clicking on this X icon here. Cool! We just completed a very basic game loop, so we can remove step number 2 from our list. We have made progress. The third step in creating our Pong game is to draw the paddles and the ball. First of all, let's see how Pygame draws things on the screen. We have three basic concepts to learn: the display surface, a regular surface, and a rectangle. The display surface is the surface where we see all the game objects. It's like the blank canvas we talked about before. The display surface is created when we call the setMod function, and it's the object we use when we call the update function. A regular surface is a surface like the display surface that we can draw on. We can have as many surfaces as we want in a game, unlike the display surface, which can only have one per game. We are going to use surfaces to draw text on the display surface. A rectangle is a rectangular area. It has a position and a size. We use rects for collision detection and easy manipulation of objects, as we are going to find out in a minute. Now that we know the basics of how drawing works in Pygame, let's draw our first object, the ball. First of all, we have to create a rect to contain the ball. This rectangle will be invisible, but it will help us position the object on the screen, and it will also help us with the collisions later. So, before the game loop, we create a rect with this line of code. Ball is equal to pygame.rect, parentheses, 0, 0, 30, 30. This line of code creates a rect object. The first two values are the x and y coordinates of the top left corner of the rect. The next two values are the width and the height of the rect. So we created a rectangle that is 30 by 30 pixels, and it is positioned at the top left corner of the screen. Now that we have the rect, we can draw it on the screen. We do that with this line of code, but now inside the game loop. Pygame.draw rect, parenthesis, screen, comma, white, comma, ball. The first argument is the display surface we want to draw the object on. The second argument is the color of the object. Pygame has a lot of built-in color strings defined to make our lives easier. So, since we need the ball to be white, we just type white in quotes. The last argument is the rect we want to draw. So, this line of code draws a white rectangle that is 30 by 30 pixels, and it is positioned at the top left corner of the screen. Let's run the game to see what happens. As you can see, the game drew a square at the top left corner of the screen, because that's where we positioned it, at 0, 0, which is the origin of the window. What do we need to do if we want the ball to be at the center of the screen? The rect object has several virtual attributes, which can be used to move and align it. You can think of these attributes as handles, and when you move one, the rect object moves in that direction. For example, we can grab a rectangle from its top left handle and move it around. Or we can grab it from its center or from the right handle, whatever suits us on every occasion. In our case, we want to move the ball to the center of the screen, so the easiest way to do it is to move the ball from its center. We just place the center of the ball at the center of the screen. So we change the center attribute. Ball.center is equal to parentheses screen width over 2, comma, screen height over 2. We need a tuple with two values. The first value is the x coordinate and the second value is the y coordinate. We want the center x coordinate to be at the center of the screen, so we set it to be screen width divided by 2. And we set the center y coordinate at screen height divided by 2. Let's run the game to see what happens. As you can see, the ball is now positioned at the center of the screen. Cool. But the ball does not look like a ball. It is a square. How can we turn this square into a circle? That's easy. In this line of code where we draw the rect, we need to call the drawElipse function instead of the drawRect function. Now, if we run the game, we can see a ball placed in the middle of the screen. Very cool. Now, let's create the two paddles. Again, we need to create two rectangle objects first to contain the paddles. Let's start with the paddle the CPU will control. I'll call it CPU. CPU is equal to pygame.rect parentheses 0, 0, 20, 100. Let's position it at 0, 0 for start and give it a width of 20 pixels and a height of 100 pixels. Now let's draw it. In the game loop, after drawing the ball, let's draw the CPU paddle. pygame.draw.rect parentheses screen, white, CPU. If we run the game at this point, the CPU paddle is drawn at the top left corner like the ball was before. Let's move it down. In order to move it down, we need to increase the y coordinate of the rectangle. One easy way to do it is to move the center y attribute of the CPU object. CPU.centerY is equal to screen height over 2. If we run the game now, we can see the CPU paddle centered vertically. Now let's create the player paddle. I'll call it player. Player is equal to pygame.rect parentheses 0, 0, 20, 100. We create a rect with the same size of the CPU paddle. Now let's draw it. pygame.draw.rect parentheses screen, white, player. We draw it at the top left corner for now. Let's move it to its proper position. From all the attributes of the rect, one easy way to move it where we want is to change the mid-right attribute. player.midRight is equal to screen width, screen height over 2. Okay, as you can see, now both the paddles and the ball are positioned where we wanted them to be. Now let's draw a line that separates the two sides. This one is easy. We just need to call the draw.aaLine function in the game loop. pygame.draw.aaLine parentheses. Now we need the surface, which is green, the color, white, and two tuples with the starting and the end points of the line. The starting point is going to be this point, which has coordinates screen width over 2, 0, and the ending point is this one, which has coordinates screen width over 2, screen height. So we enter these coordinates here, and when we run the game, we can see the line as well. Cool, our game elements are ready. Now, let's animate them. So far, we have created three rectangles for the ball and the two paddles, and we have moved them to the correct position on the screen, and in the game loop, we draw them at the same position 60 times per second. If we want to animate these rectangles, all we have to do is to move their position a little bit at each execution of the game loop. Since we update the screen 60 times per second, this tiny movement is perceived as continuous movement. First, let's animate the ball. Outside of the game loop, we create two variables which will hold the ball speed in the x and the y direction. Ball speed x is equal 6. Ball speed y is equal 6. Now in the game loop, we have to move the ball rectangle in x and y by the ball speed. So we write ball.x plus equal ball speed x and ball y plus equal ball speed y. These two lines of code increase the x and y coordinates of the ball rectangle by 6 pixels each time the game loop is run. Let's run the game to see what happens. As you can see, it almost works. The ball moves, but we have two problems to fix. The first problem is that the ball leaves a trace of its previous position. We can fix that easily with just one line of code. But first, let's talk about how the game loop draws the elements on the screen. In every game loop, our game executes these commands one after another. First, it draws the line, then the ball, and then the paddles. It does that 60 times per second. Each time it draws something on the screen, it does not erase what was drawn before. That's why the ball leaves a trace when it moves. So, all we have to do is to clear the screen in every game loop before drawing the game objects in their new positions. So, before drawing the objects, we simply type screen.fill black. With this command, we tell the computer to fill the display surface we are drawing on with black color, and this way we are clearing it. As you can see, we run the game once more. Now the ball does not leave a trace, so the animation works as expected. So we have completed step number 4 as well. That was fast, wasn't it? The second problem we have to fix is that the ball moves out of the game window. This is step number 5, and we are going to work on it at once. To solve this issue and make the ball bounce, we will work once more with the ball rectangle. As we said before, we have some attributes to work with. Let's make the ball bounce when it hits the bottom of the screen. The easiest way to do it is to select the ball.bottom attribute. So in the game loop we type if ball.bottom greater than or equal to screen height. Here we check if the bottom of the ball rectangle is more than equal to the screen height. If that's true, the ball must bounce. All we have to do is to change the direction of the ball in the vertical axis. To do this, we simply multiply the ball speed y by minus 1. So we type ball speed y asterisk equal minus 1. We can do the same if the top of the ball rectangle is less than or equal to 0, to check if it is going outside of the window from the top. In the same if statement, we just add or ball.top less than or equal to 0. With the same technique, we can check for collisions at the left and the right side of the game window. If ball.right greater than equal to screen width, or ball.left less than or equal to 0, now we have to change the direction of the ball in the horizontal axis. So we have to change the ball speed x variable. Ball speed x asterisk equals minus 1. And with that, we just completed step number 5. As you can see, when we run the game, the ball bounces around always inside the game window. Cool, huh? One thing I have to point out is that in the if statement here, we don't compare if two values are equal with the double equal sign. If the ball moved one pixel per time, the equality would work. At some point, the ball would hit exactly the end of the window. Since we are moving the ball by 6 pixels per frame, the ball will not always hit the exact end of the window. So we check if the ball moved beyond the end of the window, and then we reverse its speed. Also, before moving to the next step, we have to start organizing our code a little bit better. We now have written a lot of code, and as we continue to write more code, our code will become harder and harder to read. To make things easier, we need to start creating some functions. So we can get this block of code, which is responsible for animating the ball, and create a function from it. So let's remove this block of code and replace it with a function named animateBall. Now let's create the function definition. At the top of our file, we define the new function named animateBall, and we paste in it the code to animate the ball we wrote earlier. Now let's try to run the code once more. As you can see, we get an error. Python says that some variables are referenced before assignment. What does it mean? Well, inside the function, we are trying to change the values of the ball speed x and ball speed y variables. The problem is that we have declared these variables outside of the function, in the global scope, as we say. So if we need to change these variables inside the function, in the local scope, we need to tell the function about them. So we have to type at the beginning of the function global ball speed x, ball speed y. If we just wanted to use them without changing their values, we could have omitted declaring them as global. Now that we declare them as global variables, we can access them and change their values. So if we run the program once more, we can see the ball is moving as before. Cool. Now, let's work on step number 6. Let's make the player paddle move up when the player presses the up arrow key and move down when the player presses the down arrow key. First of all, we have to know when the player presses the key and when the user releases that key. So inside the game loop, where we check for events and process them, we add this code. If event.type equals pygame.keyDown, this line of code checks if the event type is equal to the keyDown constant, which means the player has pressed a key. Now we have to know which key the player pressed. We have a constant for each key in the keyboard. To know which key the player pressed, we can use the event.key attribute. The event.key attribute returns a constant representing a key that was pressed. Now we can check if the player pressed the up arrow key. We can do that with this if statement. If event.key equals pygame.keyUp, as you can see, we are checking if the event.key constant is equal to the pygame.keyUp constant, which represents the up arrow key. If the player presses the up arrow key, we have to move the paddle up. To achieve this, we have to declare a player speed variable outside of the game loop and set it to 0. Now, in the game loop, we have to move the player paddle rectangle. So we add this line of code, player.y plus equals player speed. The player speed is currently 0. But we can change it when a button is pressed. So when the up key is pressed, we just set the player speed to minus 6. The speed is negative because we want to move the paddle up. And since the origin of our screen is at the top left, if we want to move upward, we need to decrease the y coordinate. We do the same when the user presses the down key. If event.key is equal to pygame.keyDown, player speed is equal to 6. Cool. Now we tell the game what to do when the user releases the up or down key. What do we want the game to do in that case? We want to stop the paddle from moving. So we need to set the paddle speed to 0. We copy the above block of code and we change this if statement here. Instead of key down, we want to be notified when the user releases the button. Now all we have to do is to set the player speed to 0 when the player releases any of the buttons. Easy. Let's now try our game. Great! I can move the player paddle up and down and it stops when I release the buttons. But there is a problem with our code. The paddle can move outside of the screen. We have to fix it before moving on. The fix is easy. All we have to do is to use the player rectangle. If the top of the rectangle is less than 0, it means that it is outside of the top of our window. So we need to place it back inside the window. If player.top less than or equal to 0, player.top is equal to 0. We do the same thing for the bottom of the screen. If player.bottom greater than or equal to screen height, player.bottom is equal to screen height. Now let's get all this code and put it inside a function to make things easier to read. We create a new function named animateplayer and we paste the player code in. We also have to call it inside the game loop. We have just completed another step. Let's cross it out from our list. Now, let's make the computer move the paddle, which is the next step in the list. For this, we are going to use a very basic but effective artificial intelligence algorithm. All we have to do is to check if the center y of the ball is above the center y of the paddle. If it is, we move the paddle up. If it is not, we move the paddle down. First of all, we have to decide how fast the computer paddle will move. In this case, we are going to set the computer speed to 6. We will call this variable CPU speed and we set it to 6. Now we have to make the computer move. We do that in the game loop. We have to move the CPU paddle rectangle. So we add this line of code, CPU.y plus equals CPU speed. The computer speed is set to 6 and it is constant, so the computer paddle will always move down. So now we have to make the computer paddle move up or down depending on the position of the center of the ball. To achieve this, we need to check if the center y coordinate of the ball rectangle is less than or equal to the center y of the CPU paddle rectangle. And if it is, we move the paddle up. If ball.center y less than or equal to CPU center y, computer speed is equal to minus 6. If the ball center y is greater than the center y of the CPU paddle, we have to move the paddle down. So we give the CPU speed a positive value. If ball.center y greater than or equal to CPU center y, CPU speed is equal to 6. Of course, here we face the same problem as before. If we don't limit the paddle, it can move outside of the game window. Let's fix it the same way we did it with the player paddle. If CPU.top less than or equal to 0, CPU.top is equal to 0. We do the same thing for the bottom of the screen. If CPU.bottom greater than or equal to screen height, CPU bottom is equal to screen height. Now let's try the code. As you can see, it works. Also, let's move this code into a function, def animate CPU, and we paste the code we wrote inside. We also have to call the function here in the game loop. As you can see, the code does not work because we are trying to alter the value of a variable, the CPU speed, which was declared in the global scope. We have to declare it as global in the function. Now it works. Great! We can move the player paddle and the computer can control its own paddle. Now we need a way to detect if the ball collides with the paddles. Luckily for us, the Pygame module makes collision detection extremely easy. There is the collideRect method on each rectangle, which returns true if it collides with another rectangle and false if it is not. So all we have to do is to check if the ball rectangle collides with the paddles. We do that in just one line of code. Inside the animate ball function, we add the following code. If ball.collideRect parenthesis player or ball.collideRect CPU. Now we need to change the direction of the ball movement in the horizontal axis. So we type ball speed x asterisk equals minus 1. Let's check the code we wrote by playing the game. As you can see, the code works. The collisions work. With just two lines of code, we added collisions to the game. How cool is that? Now, the last thing we have to do to complete the game is to add scoring to it. First of all, let's create two variables to hold the points for each player. I am going to call the first one CPU points and the other one player points, and I will initialize both with 0, like this. Now we have to check whether the player or the CPU wins a point. The CPU wins a point when the ball hits the end of the screen here, and the player wins a point when the ball hits the other end here. So inside the animate ball function, we have to make some changes to the code. We have to break this if statement into parts. If ball.right greater than or equal to screen width, the CPU wins a point when this happens. So let's create a new function called point1 and pass in the argument CPU in quotes. Then we have to check if the player wins. If ball.left less than or equal to 0, point1, parentheses, quotes, player. Now we have to create the definition of the function. As we saw, we pass a string to the function, which is either CPU or player. In other words, we pass the winner of the point. So we create a function that takes only one argument. Let's call it winner. So inside the function, all we have to do is to check who is going to be awarded with a point. We have declared the CPU points and the player points variables in the global scope. So in order to change them, we need to declare them inside the function definition as globals, like this. Now we can change their values. If winner is equal to quotes CPU, CPU points plus equals 1. If winner equals player, player points plus equals 1. Cool. Now we can display the points on the screen. In Pygame, to create and display some text, we need to follow three steps. First, we need to create a font, then a surface with the text we want to display, and then we can display that surface using the bleed method of the display surface object. So, outside of the game loop, let's create a font and call it score font. So, score font is equal to pygame.font.font, and we have to give it a font family and a size. For the font family, I will enter none, so it will use the default font of the Pygame module. For the size of the font, I'll give it the value 100. The first step is done. Now we have to create two surfaces, one for the CPU score and one for the player score inside the game loop. To do this, we use the render method from our score font object. We pass in the string that we want to display, we set the anti-alias argument to true, and finally we set the color of the font. I am going to set it to white. The string we want to display is just the points, and since this is an int variable, we have to convert it to string before being able to use it. So we have the CPU score surface, and we create another surface for the player score, just like this. Now we can call the bleed method to display the surfaces to the display surface we have named screen. Bleed means block image transfer. Most of the time in Pygame we are going to be bleeding images to the display surface. We have to pass in the surface that we want to display and the location on the screen. So we type screen.bleed CPU score surface and the position we want it to be, let's say screen width over 4,20. We do the same for the player score surface. Now, if I run the game, we will see the score for both players. If we let the computer win, we can see that the ball disappears and the CPU score keeps increasing. That's something we have to fix. It's easy, don't worry. Let's go to the point one function and let's add a call to a new function named, let's say, reset ball. When the CPU or the player gets a point, we want to move the ball back to the center of the screen. So let's modify its x and y coordinates. For x, let's put in the middle of the x-axis, and for the y-axis, let's get a random value from 10 to 100 pixels. To do so, we need to import the random module and then use the randint function like this. This function will return a random number from 10 to 100 and it will assign it to the y attribute of the ball rectangle. Now let's modify the ball speed as well. Let's randomize the direction at which the ball is going every time we reset it. Again, we need to define both ball speed x and ball speed y coordinates as global. Now we can use the choice function from the random module to give the ball a positive or negative speed at its axis randomly. The choice function randomly selects an element from this list, either 1 or minus 1, and multiplies that with the ball speed. That's it! Believe it or not, our game is ready. We can test it out and see that it is working great. Of course, there are a lot of things we can improve on this game. We built the most basic version of the Pong game possible to learn how to work with Python and Pygame. As always, you can find the full code of this tutorial in the video description. I hope this tutorial was useful and that you learned the basics of Pygame. If you like the video, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing to the channel if you don't want to miss my future tutorials. Thanks for watching and I'll see you next time.